Yes, sir.
The man is looking for you. Did he catch you?
No, I hadn't found him.
Let me ask you a question.
All right.
Let me ask you a question.
Thank you. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just lift you up and we praise your precious and holy name. And Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity that we have to come into your house today and to hear the true gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ preached. And Lord, we just thank you for your many blessings. Lord, we pray for our pastor and for the many other folks within our service that just need your healing and raising hand. Lord, we pray that you'll be with Brother Allen this morning as he brings us the message. And Lord, just meet the needs. Meet the need of our heart and the spirit. And Lord, that we may indeed go out of here filled with your word and to teach others about you. We ask these things now in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let's turn to our heavens while we're standing to 441. Great is thy faithfulness, O God thy Father.
Still painful, and he said he labors when he gave him some additional pain medication, which later last night and again this morning, he says that the pain medication is helping. He does have an MRI scheduled for Tuesday for this issue to see if that will show anything more specific. So, Pastor's still in a lot of pain. He's not out of the woods yet with his breathing. And we just ask that you continue. Jennifer, did I leave anything out, or is that basically? Okay. All right, that's pretty much where we are. And I checked again with the pastor this morning just to see if there was any significant change, and he said no, that it wasn't. One thing that I talked to a couple of people, and I talked with Cookie this morning. Cookie wants us to pray for her brother-in-law, Forrest, and his wife, Pat Alves. They were in an extremely serious and bad automobile accident last week, and both of them are in the hospital and in very poor condition. So please pray for Forrest and Pat Alves. Debbie Driver on Wednesday night, Debbie told us that the grandkids were doing fine, but now her daughter, Leslie, had the COVID. Then we got a message yesterday that, in addition to that, Leslie was in St. Francis Hospital with bilateral or double pneumonia. So continue to pray. I talked to Debbie just a few minutes ago, and she said there's no significant change with that. So, but still, please, please continue to pray for Leslie there. Had a nice long chat again with Rich Donahoe Sr., and Rich is still having difficulties. He's having difficulties both with his lungs and with his heart, and he's getting his doctors to check on that. Because of his condition, he was supposed to have a lung biopsy later on in the month, but they have moved that biopsy up until this Tuesday. So must be something more going on there. So continue to pray for Rich Donahoe Sr. In his condition, because the heart and the lungs, he's having issues with both of those. Thanks to John and Nack, got an update yesterday that our member Horace Lauer, who's been in a nursing home for quite some time, his daughter Sharon communicated with Donna and indicated that his Alzheimer's is now in a very, very advanced condition, and that Horace is deteriorating. So pray for Horace Larry, if you would. So there are all the medical updates that we have on that. But in a much brighter note, we're going to wish Donna a birthday coming up on Wednesday. And Alan, did you remember that? I hope you did.
Thank you.
And that new car trip will certainly arrive by Wednesday, I'm sure. So happy birthday to Donna. Anybody else, as far as the condition of a church or a folks, anybody else have anything that you'd like to share? Buddy?
Ray's here.
Amen.
Alice is here.
Amen.
Alice
is here.
Arnie's here.
Arnie's here.
Amen.
In his own car.
All the old people coming home to roost.
We're glad. The old folks, he said the old folks are coming home to roost. We're glad of that. We're so glad of that. And one quick thing, but Barney, the last report in a while, she was doing so much better, doing okay?
Doing good.
All right, good. Barbara's doing great. Wanda?
Pray for Bill's test.
Pull that mask down so everybody can hear.
Pray for Bill's test results. We hope we get it Tuesday when the doctor comes back. He's at MCV 4 days a week, and he comes to the VA on Tuesday. So we're hoping to hear from the bone aspiration test to see if he can move forward with the hip replacement. So we're hoping to hear something Tuesday.
Amen.
It's been on spring break.
Okay.
All right.
Well, thank you for that. And as you all know, and particularly on Wednesday night, when we get into a whole lot more detail about things on Wednesday, but we communicate a whole lot, and I appreciate the updates, and also appreciate the notes that we get on a regular basis from Wanda, and just some of the difficulties. You know, I've said on more than one occasion that when you talk about one missionary, it sort of seems like that each of them are having the same difficulties. Well, with what's been going on in John's family and the way the Lord has worked, I would just ask you bear with me for a few extra minutes so that I can go through this letter in detail. Dear pastor and praying friends, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Psalm 61:1-3. The past few months have been overwhelming to us, but God has been our rock, and we have leaned upon him through all of this. As many of you know, my dad, Howard Wynn, who served as a missionary in the Philippines for 41 years, was graduated to glory on February the 6th. Let me explain what has transpired this year. We were excited to start 2021 and perform a wedding on January the 5th, and one of our young adult couples that was studying and leading to go to Taiwan. This was our son Joshua's best friend, so we were all excited that he was going to be a groomsman for the very first time. But the weekend before the wedding, Christy and the boys had a cough and congestion, so we decided to have them tested for COVID-19 to be sure that they were negative and we wouldn't spread anything at the wedding. On Monday the 4th, a lady from the neighborhood showed up at our gate and said that Christy had tested positive and would be taken immediately. So if you can imagine just how this is. Somebody shows up at your door and said, you are coming with me right now. Get your clothes. Let's go. Had tested positive and would be taken immediately to a facility and be isolated from the rest of us. The normal protocol was to be put in that facility for 14 days. We asked if she could just stay with the rest of us and be in quarantine there for 2 weeks. We all missed the wedding, but my dad, so this is back in January now, So my dad performed the wedding in our absence. It only made Christy stay in the facility for a week, but it was still a very difficult time for all of us. We were finally able to get Joshua out of quarantine and get him back to the States for college, and he only missed a few days of classes. Well, we realize now that God was giving Joshua extra time here to spend with his grandfather before he knew that he would be gone. Within a few weeks. At the end of January, all of us expected Emily, including our parents, to be given the COVID symptoms. We eventually took Dad to the hospital, and we prayed fervently for the Lord to heal him. God answers our prayers, but not in the way that we expected, because he passed away. My mom had been with him at the hospital through this entire ordeal. And who had also tested positive and had to be quarantined for the 14-day period. Christy and the kids were quarantined at the house, and I stayed with Mom. I must admit that there were some frightening days trying to be sure that Mom was on the mend from the virus and grieving over my dad and my mentor. That church was hurting, but we could not get together. The services had gone online, and several of the churches, people in their churches had gotten sick as well. There were some difficult days, but God was faithful to his word and brought comfort to each one of us. Our church people were amazing in bringing food and groceries to the family and helped us care for Mom. She is doing well, but they're trying to get my sister, Angela, here to take Mom back to the States. She needs cataract surgery and she's been suffering with Parkinson's for 17 years. So they need to try to get her back. So it goes on to say that there was difficulty in getting his sister the approval to get back into the Philippines. And once you get into the Philippines, then she has to go through quarantine to be able to get back into the States again. So in the middle of all of this, they were buying property in a new church. And a lot of things were going on. Now, one of the things with the dad who was in Tacloban, the two different areas, John Wynn and his family were taking care of the church in Dulag. His dad had been because they couldn't even get out because of the quarantine to take care of his dad's funeral. So some very, very difficult times. But as he finishes up and he shows some pictures of even now of baptism and in Dulac, and also they're getting able to get out now. They do a real big event each year with some military services people close by. So things are, even though they went through this extremely difficult time, things are beginning to come back together. But he thanks us for our prayers, he thanks us for our support, and asks that we will continue to pray for them because they got a whole lot going on. And usually when we have a letter, it's talking about the camp and what's going on at the camp. They have a huge youth camp and young adult camp, but that has been closed for now for over a year. But he said they've been able to do some work and upgrade the property, and they hope that they will be able to start the camp services again before the end of the year. So pray for John and Christy and the entire family. Pray for Josh, who's now back here and back in college, and for John's mom, who's, as soon as the approval is received, will be headed back to the States for the cataract surgery and treatment for the Alzheimer's. So as you can see, even through it all, and John, and there were some other parts of here, that John is just continuing, even with all of this difficulty, to give praise to the Lord for what he's doing and for the ministry and how the ministry has continued. And he said that even with the new property and new people and new exposure, that their membership is even growing. Even though they have to have some services online, the membership and the numbers are continuing to increase. So pray for John and Christy and all the folks there that minister in the Philippines, and continue to pray for all of our missionaries. Thank you.
truth that's contained in 1 Peter, just three verses, I think. It's just three.
Yes.
And then we're going to turn to, I actually mentioned this Wednesday night. Do you remember Hannah?
Yeah.
Does anybody remember Hannah? She, we're going to read her prayer. We talked about it just Wednesday night a little bit, and go into a little bit more detail today about Hannah's prayer. The name of the message is Overflowing. Overflowing. That song that we just sang is one of my favorite songs. And that's kind of, it sort of gives that idea of overflowing. What a wonderful, wonderful thoughts are in that song, right? Walks with me, talks with me. Just wonderful thoughts there. Anyway, I'd like to be there all the time, right? Walking and talking with the Lord. What a wonderful spot for each one of us to know Him as Savior, just to be with Him. You know, that's actually His intent. He's going to return things back to the way He wants them one day. And we will walk and talk with Him. And we'll all be guarded. Won't be any briars and thorns and things like that. So that's a common sense. That's a good song. Anyway, if you turn to 1 Peter 5, 1 Peter chapter 5, and we're going to read verses 5, 6, and 7. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud, giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, verse 6, under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time, casting all your cares upon Him, for He careth for you. Good thoughts there, huh? Really good thoughts we see from Peter. And very similar to the topic that we had in Sunday school this morning, which is humbling yourselves. I wonder why there's so much instruction in the Bible about humbling ourselves. What do you think? Anybody have any idea?
It's hard for us to do.
It's really hard for us to do it. We got born into the family of God, but and that's awesome.
Yes.
I mean, it's settled. That's awesome. And there's so much more here, though, before we go to be with Him. And it does require a humbling to receive the blessings of our Lord. It does require that in our lives. And so we receive instruction on that. And the result of following that can be nothing except glory to God. If we'll humble ourselves, if we'll do the thing instructed us in our lives, it can be nothing but good. So let's look at these three verses. We'll take them one at a time, a couple of points to make on each one, and then we're going to turn to 1 Samuel and read the prayer of Hannah. So, chapter 5, verse 5, likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves to the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another. Be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud and giveth grace to the humble. So we see, first of all, this ye younger, that would be not necessarily an age. If it was an age, probably nobody here would need to listen to it. Oh, no, this is younger means pretty much those that were newer to the faith, ye younger, rather than the more mature Christians, those that had grown and become more like their Savior. It could also mean the youth, however, but definitely means the newer believers. It can even mean deacons rather than the church. Preachers and teachers. attained to the office of pastor or bishop. So anyway, we see that verse there. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. The elder would be those that are mature in the faith, the pastor. Those that have been in the faith for a long time have been growing in the faith. And he says, all of you then, look in the verse, yea, all of you, be subject one to another. Be subject one to another. Let's look at that. You know, we're told this is not to step on any toes at all, simply using scripture. We're told to forsake not the assembling of ourselves together. Now, some is. There's a reason given in there. It's to edify each other, comfort each other, build each other up in faith. More so, as you see, a day approach. If you live in America, you see a day approaching, right? I mean, what we don't know when it's going to be, but you can see things accelerating, right? In the wickedness. And that's a sign, you know, like you see the fig tree you put forth its leaves. You should know that something's coming up. There's going to be some fruit going on. And when you see that, then you should see a sign of the times, right? So, when we're looking in here, and look at this verse, yea, all of you be subject one to another. What does that mean? Getting together as believers is really important. It's really important.
Right.
We had to forsake not the assembly in that verse, but then we see Peter saying, all of you. What does that mean? That means care for each other more than you care for yourselves. And this is what it means. Care for, what does that mean? Prayer. And we pray a lot for each other around here. I hope we continue and grow. Pray even more than we have.
Amen.
Because it's needed, right?
Amen.
Not just for healing, but for guidance and, you know, protection. And wisdom, knowledge. I pray for our pastor to get back up in here, right? And I know he's praying to get back in here too, but I also have prayed many times that God would do things in his life that would make him into exactly what he wants him to be. Mm-hmm. Now, you mean that doesn't always happen? No, it doesn't always happen. God doesn't want you to be a wimpy, nothing believer. He wants us all to be tip-top. He wants us to all grow and become like his son. That's what he wants from all of us. But some of us refuse that. That's why we should be here. Submit one to another. All of us submit one to another. Get involved. Make prayer part of the prayer. You know, when you pray, some of you do this. You actually remember where some of the folks sit here, right? So when you pray, you can remember them by remembering where they're seated sometimes. In your mind, it kind of goes that way. And we should be praying for each other. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. We're a family. We truly are a family. By the Spirit of God, that's who we are. So be subject one to another. And then the next part, and be clothed with humility. Be clothed with humility. So let me go back to the first point. So it's not just the elders that are to submit. It's not just the younger. It's not just the pastor. It's not just deacons. It's every one of you. Likewise, all of you be subject one to another. Make it part of your day. Right? Part of your day. And be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. Be clothed with humility. It's an interesting word. Clothed, the word. It's used once in the Bible, one time. And interesting facts about the word. Clothed with humility. It means to knot, K-N-O-T, knot, tie, or fasten to yourself the apron of a slave or a servant. They would wear this like apron or something to cover their regular clothes, which were also shabby for the most part. They were slaves or servants, but it was to keep, when they were working at their master's bidding, it would keep the filth off of them, and it was an extremely humble garment. So let's look at the verse, that part of the verse, garment that a servant, a slave, would tie to themselves, and it would be not, listen, tied up to humility, covered with humility. What does that mean? That everybody else is more important than I am. I'm putting everybody else first. That includes the Lord, by the way. Talk about that in Sunday school a lot. It's God first, everybody else, me second, but it's also me second. Listen, when you see a person who's wacko, wacko in their actions and words, do you curse them or do you pray for them? I mean, just an example, but there are people in Congress and in our government who need pray. They're not saved.
That's right.
You and I would be the same way on every one of those issues if we weren't saved.
Right.
We're convinced of things because of what? God's work in our hearts and lives. God's word. We're convinced of it as Christian believers. And I know the only God is going to take me home to be with him for an eternity. I know this. I know that I'm forgiven. You, and you know all these things also. You also know that he is righteousness. If you want to know what's true and righteous, it's God. You only got to look at his word to see what righteousness is and goodness is and love, mercy, holiness, all of these words. And so we see that we ought to be not putting self above others. These are hard messages to talk about, hard lessons to talk about, because we also have to take care of our family, right? We have to go get that next job or that promotion. Most of you all don't work for you, so all of you retired. But, I said bush of us. I said us. Did I say us? I meant us. Retired, right? But there's so many things out there in life that don't seem bad, and they probably aren't bad in and of themselves. But what should come first? Be subject one to another. Be subject to God. Subject one to another. So we see then we see God resists the proud. See the very end of that verse 5. For God resists the proud. So be clothed with humility because God is going to be against you if you keep that pride. What would that pride mean? You just go on doing what you've always done. You hear the word of God, you know that you're not right with something there, but you do nothing about it. That's pride. I don't mean anything. God says it, but I'm not going to deal with that. Or just forget it. Wouldn't that be kind of a pride thing going on? And the scripture says if you're not clothed with humility, if it's not hooked on you and covering you, then God is going to, what does the verse say? He resists the proud. That word is used in army terminology in other sources. The resists is in battle array. In other words, he's set everything up in his system. He has set it up to where he opposes we who are walking around in our self-importance. Make sense? So let's read the verse. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves to the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another. Be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud. And then the last one is this. He gives grace to the humble. You say, I thought grace was just about salvation. No, we know that's not true. And we know, by the way, God just didn't become a God of grace in the New Testament. Did you know that? There are so many people that teach you used to get saved a different way in the Old Testament. They're lie. They do not know the scriptures. God was also always a God of grace. Is always a God of grace. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you die the first time you sin. That's an easy argument there. But did he redeem Egypt? Did he redeem Israel out of Egypt? salvation, but it's also in our lives. And look, he gives grace to the humble. Gives grace to the humble. Humility is the vessel of all graces. In other words, if you and I want all the grace of God, you know, all the grace, not just salvation, then it stops there. And a lot of us stop there. A lot of us stop there. We never grew. And maybe it's our fault. Maybe it was the teaching. Maybe it was preaching. Maybe it was that you don't listen. Maybe you never study. Maybe you're never in prayer. Maybe you're not saved. I don't know. But here's the deal. If you want all of the grace of God, you can leave some of it on the table. Is that a true statement? Yeah. You miss out. We can miss out on God's grace. By what? By what we act by. Humility or being in subjection to. Humility. Being in subjection to rather than pride. Rather than I'm going to do it my way. I'm saved. I don't need any of the rest of this. And when we look at the empty pews, there are many. And I'm not talking about anybody sick, whoever's at home. I'm talking about those who would choose to just not come because there's nothing here. I don't need anything. They're going to open God's Word and preach out of God's Word, teach out of God's Word, but I'm saved. There's anything else? No. There's more grace. Look, the end of the verse. It gives grace to the humble. You have to humble yourself for salvation. Is that true? Sure you do. Admit you're a sinner. Admit you can't do anything about it. You can't unsin. You can't get rid of that putrid sore that's all over your body that God sees because you're a sinner. But so you humble there, but you have to be humble to take his growing up order. You have to say, he knows better than me. I'm going to do that. If he says this is the way to go, if he says pray without ceasing, I need to pray more. And I've heard a lot of people say that's an attitude of prayer. I believe that because naturally you can't continually walk around and pray and do anything else. But an attitude of prayer is you see God in everything. He kept you out of that accident. He kept me alive through the accident. He got me out of the hospital. He's healed me up. He showed me something out of his word. You're seeing God all the time. But there's grace to those who are humble. And this guy, Augustine, wrote this. Humility is the vessel of all graces. If you want, you must be humble to receive the graces of God. All the grace of God. The full helping. In other words, you got to come starved to the table. You got to come so hungry that you're going to suck it up. You're going to take it in and you're going to let it grow out of your body and change you, change your life into something that glorifies God. So we see that. Look at verse 6 then. So we have verse 5. Likewise, younger, submit yourselves to the elder. They all can be subject one to another. Be clothed with humility. God resists the proud. Gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. So humble. So this argument that he just continues on. So humble yourself. Here's the deal. Without humility, you won't receive all of my grace. I'm a God of all grace, but you can't receive it because you don't need it. In your mind, you don't need it. You show it all the time. See? Do you see what we're saying? Everybody's so quiet. I haven't been up here that long now. Come on. So, verse 6. So humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he might exalt you in due time. Place yourself under the one who's higher than you and me. Right? The rock that's higher than I think the song says. So we can see that's where we belong. These are instructions where you belong. In humility at God's throne. Day by day by day. And when we're mixing as brothers and sisters in Christ, we are subject one to another because that builds each other up. And you can correct my error in thinking or my error of doing or me, you, and we're strengthening each other simply by being around. And how many people here, you've given somebody a prayer request, just a friend saying, "Would you pray for so-and-so?" And listen, what are they doing? They're building you up. What did they just do? They're saying, "You pray too, because I've already prayed. I want some other people praying." Doesn't that build you up? You're supposed to pray. So you're getting built up. You see? You understand what I'm saying? I don't know. But let me continue on. Humble yourselves. We belong in humility under God's guiding hand instead of our own guiding hand. Your own guiding hand is what you ever did. You always did it all the way. God didn't kill you, so why quit? I'm saved. I ain't doing that. And that's what we do sometimes. I'll never forget when I first got saved in 81 or 82, whatever it was. It's gotten so old, not too long ago now, I don't remember what year. It was one of those, I think. But I can remember missing church after a month or two. Right at first, I would come over. I sat at the same place in that church. It would have been about where Terry is. Sitting by myself, because nobody else was with me, and I didn't get alive. I didn't know a thing. And I would just, man, it was just awesome. Pastor Maggie was just teaching that Bible, and I was taking it, and I just loved it. And then I missed church to do something I wanted to do. I don't know what it was. I don't remember now. I kid you not. Just as clear as a bell, the thought came to me. He didn't do anything about it. God didn't do anything. I missed. I'm supposed to be there. I think if that was a thought for me, I'm either a little off. Some of you that know me, I'm a little off sometimes, but in this, I don't think that I am. That God just lets us go on. You know something? God sometimes just lets you go on in your sin. Mm-hmm. Because your punishment is the sin you're in, and you can't get out of it without Him.
Yeah.
And somehow He just says, "Go on. I'm here." Humble yourself, that means come back. I'll deal with you. Blessings come when you come back to me.
Right.
Humility, humbleness.
Amen.
I need you. I'm wrong in my life. It needs change. I know I'm saved, but nothing moves me anymore. And you just leave me here. Not His fault. Out of love, He's leading you there. And out of His continuing work of mercy and grace, His mercy is everlasting.
Yeah. Yeah, sweet.
Golly dang, that's your God and mine. His mercy is everlasting. So put yourself under Him for guidance, under His mighty hand. Why mighty hand? Because my hand isn't. His hand is what causes things to happen. And He is the Creator. He demonstrated His power perfectly, not just at creation, but here at the resurrection. We talked about it last week. He showed His power at the resurrection. He could raise a man from the dead and in the grave for 3 days.
Amen.
And raise
him. Right.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And why did He do it? So that you could see what's in store for you. You're going to be raised one day at the resurrection time for you. And you'll be sharing in His glory. And even now, we do share in His glory. So let Him guide you. Then, end of verse 6. That He may exalt you in due time. So when it's time, your exaltation comes. Remember earlier today, if you were in Sunday school, we talked about this. Jesus had to go through the humiliation before He got to the exaltation. Yes? And He now has a name that's above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess.
Right.
That's who He is. He's above every name in heaven and earth. That includes above every angel, above everybody. Jesus is the name.
Right.
Why? Because what He did. Perfect, perfect, perfect obedience. No will of His own. And by that, He showed you and I the way.
Right.
Verse 6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under His mighty hand. The mighty hand of God. What, was He going to take you astray? We humility is the vessel of all graces. He will lift you up. Listen, I want you to think about lifting you up. It's not just at the end, it's now. Mm-hmm. Is there a pleasant joy, and sometimes even greater than just a pleasant joy, when you know you're in God's will over something?
Amen.
Don't you feel good when you say you realize what God did yesterday in your life? What do I mean? You're here. What God's doing today. What do I mean? You're here. That God's word is open. You're just saying praises to his name. Real hymns, not rock and roll. That's another subject. We'll go somewhere. Listen. He will raise you up. He will raise you up. Think about this. The joy that comes from being in the will of God, not just saved. When you got saved, if you really got saved, you felt joy.
True.
I don't care how you got saved. If you felt no joy, I would say you need to re-examine that. But I'm not you. You know in your heart. You can get with God. He'll let you know. You felt real joy. And you know, the pastor at Broadway now is Jerry Davis. He grew up in Tennessee and then moved to Virginia. He was about 10, 11 years old. He said when he got saved, he went up down the street yelling it. He's like, he's crazy, right? 40 years later, he's pastor in the church of Bible-believing Christians, right? Not too shabby. What? God's grace comes to those who put themselves under his hand of guidance. Put yourselves away. We need to put ourselves away. Imagine the goodness, the overflowing. The name of this message is overflowing. Because if we get it right, there'll be an overflowing in us. Why is that important? Because it keeps you coming back for more.
Amen.
Yes. It's so good. I want more. I tell you this based on being able to teach and preach the Word of God. I spent 40-some years teaching textbooks in public school and then kicking kids out of school as an administrator. There's nothing that ever happened in those buildings that I worked in that can compare with teaching and preaching God's Word. There is an overflowing joy in my heart. People say, how can you do this, you know, two in a row, blah, 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 blah. My pastor at Broadway did four every week, week in and week out until he was in his mid-70s. And then he started letting other people, now and then. Why did he do it? He was being fed. You see, the grace of God was coming to him, right? This is God's will. Preach the word, be in season, out of season, preach the word, right? And that's what he did, and there's a joy that's overflowing. And it's not just for those who teach and preach the word of God, it's those that receive it. God did that in my life. I just heard today in scripture. I didn't know how it worked, but now he told me. He read that verse, and God's told me what the work he's doing in my life. There's more and more and more. The more I take in, the more he gives. And it's overflowing after a while. I believe that's what we see in verse 6. And then verse 7.
Amen.
In addition to what we just said, humble yourselves. Put yourself under his mighty guiding hand. Let him lift you up. Stop lifting yourselves up in pride. Do what he says in every single way you can, and he'll exalt you at the right time. He will. And then verse 7, do this. Casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. Cast it. Toss it. Get rid of it. It's gone. Seen people leave their cares at the altar. And some of you that have been around Baptist churches long enough,
that's
you have
right.
Seen the same thing at the altar call. You've seen people weep at the altar and come back happy. You have, and they come back in the next service too. Why? They want more. Casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Get rid of it. Once you've given it to him, you gave it to him or you didn't. If you carry it back out with you, you're retaining that care. If you can't fix it, why would you keep it? Can't answer that. There is no reason to keep it. Toss it, get rid of it. All your care, the care could be an anxiety. The things that just are on your heart all the time. By the way, we're not supposed to be anxious for things, but we should be anxious for things to get better. We should be anxious for things. I'm anxious about salvation for people that I know. Yes. Children and grandchildren, brothers and sisters, and just friends. I don't want them to miss out. I know where I'm going. I don't want them to miss. I want to be there with them. I want them to be there with me, with the Lord above all, right? There's cares that we have that are not bad cares, but this is the deal. Go to him again and again and give him that and give him that and give him that. Let your heart break in prayer when you pray to God. Just let it break and say, Lord, you're going to have to pick me up because I cannot.
Right.
If you can't fix this, I don't know what I'll do, but I want you to. And listen, when he works on that thing with you, you want to know there's going to be an overflowing joy in your life. And you're going to go back to him again. Yes. Because he did it already. And you liked it. And it was wonderful. And the anxiety, the cares are gone. You cast it upon him. And he does care for us. God alone will deal perfectly with all of our cares. It'll only be done perfectly through God. Only God. You and I mess it up almost every time, right?
Right.
Listen to what Spurgeon says. This casting of care upon him has a lot to do with prayers. Please listen carefully to what Spurgeon says. Not that long. Spurgeon says this. Prayer tells God what the care is in your life. What the care is in your life and asks God to help. Prayer spreads the letter of trouble and grief before the Lord and opens it and all it contains. And then faith cries out, I believe God cares. He cares for me. I believe that he will bring me out of my distresses and make it promote his own glory in the end. Not just me. He won't just help me. He'll promote his own glory. He'll be glorified in what he does. And this letter is talking about, some of you may remember the Kings, verse 2 Kings in the Bible. Chronicles also, there was a king that was there, and I don't remember which one. He was a good king, and he had received a letter stating that we got all these people, and we're going to kill you because you can't stand before us. And he took the letter, and he laid it out at the altar of God, before God, and he prayed over it. So God delivered them from their enemies. This king put himself under the mighty hand of God because God cares for him. And Spurgeon is saying, when you go to God in prayer and spread it all out in front of him, it's saying this, I believe God cares. He cares for me. He will bring me out of my distresses. And in the end, he'll be glorified by all this done. He won't be made glorified. He will be. That's what Spurgeon says. And now, I don't want to go too long, but we're going to have to go. Look, I took the time to write it, so you got to hear
it. Amen.
Not that much. You've got the whole point of the message. But in Hannah's prayer, it'll break your heart if you think about what she's going through. Yet she prayed overflowing joy in this prayer. So turn to 1 Samuel, and we're going to read some verses and make some comments on them and then get to her prayer. 1 Samuel chapter 1. key verses just to get your mind on Hannah and what she had been going through. Chapter 1, verse 2. And he, that's the husband of Hannah, had two wives. The name of one was Hannah. The name of the other was Peninnah. Peninnah had children, Hannah had no children. Look in verse 5. But unto Hannah, he, her husband, gave a worthy portion, for he loved Hannah. But the Lord had shut up her womb. There was great anxiety here. We've been talking about casting your care upon the Lord and the overwhelming, the overflowing joy that comes. First of all, that we did what we should have done, which is given it to the Lord, and then realize whatever he does with it is for his glory and honor, period, because he cares for us, right? Because he cares for us. So we see a great anxiety. There's no child. And those that were closest to Hannah made it even worse. The co-wife, Peninnah, had all these kids, and she just rubbed it in Hannah's face every chance she got. Because children are a blessing of the Lord. So she would be telling Hannah, I'm sure, I don't love you. And boy, you're trash, and you're filthy, and on and on and on. So it was just a great source. It was a driving source in Hannah's life. She could not rid herself this feeling, bad feeling, all the time because of no children. Look in verse 10, chapter 1, verse 10. And she was in bitterness of soul, and look at what she did, and prayed to the Lord, and wept sore. Verse 11, and she vowed a vow, said unto the Lord of hosts, thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thy handmaid, and remember me, and not forget thy handmaid, but will give unto thy handmaid a man child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. The breaking point had been reached here. I don't know that she did, but that she didn't pray the same prayer many times. Don't know that, but I do know this, that God heard this one.
Amen.
This one. And her heart was broken. And thus we ought to pray sometimes with a broken heart, a brokenness about whatever issues are in your life, right? Cast your cares on him, because he cares for you, right? Let his hand guide you. Look at verse 15. And Hannah answered and said, no, my Lord. She's talking to a preacher, a priest, Eli. I'm a woman of a sorrowful spirit, and I have drunk neither wine nor suffering. But look at what she says. I have poured out my soul before the Lord. Verse 16. Count not thy handmaid for a daughter of Belial, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken hitherto. She needed relief from her life, from the things going on in her life. She had every relief from this issue. She poured out her heart and she wept. And she wept to the only one who cares for her in a perfect way. Right. Not just with kind words. Her husband actually said, hey, aren't I better to you than 10 sons, Hannah? He was just trying to be nice to her, right? It didn't lift her spirits. God did that. God did that. And look at what she says there, that she'll give him back. All days of his life, verse 11, at the very end, I'll give him back to you. The rest of his, all of his days, that which my heart desires above all, I'll give it back to God. How brokenhearted was she to say that? You all got children, some of them, right? Something to make a promise like that. Look at verse 18. And she said, let thine handmaid find grace in thy sight. She said that to Eli. So the woman went her way and did eat. And look at what this says. And her countenance was no more sad. What happened at all? Right? She gave it up for real. She cast it upon in humility. I cannot take it anymore. I can't. She had felt driven and helpless. She felt cornered by that other woman with the babies. So she arrived at the place where God wanted her, and that was on her knees at the altar in prayer. That's what he wants from you and me. Yes, he's our Lord and Savior. On her knees in prayer before him, recognizing that he's the only one that can shape my life the way that will glorify himself.
True.
There you go. The humility is this: only God. She just went to God. Not me, not my husband, not that woman. I'll kick her in the shin, but I'm not going to do it. Just God. God, only you can fix it. There was peace found, there it says there in that, her countenance was no more sad, verse 18. Peace was found and given, and it was a startling peace from the sad countenance all the time, never happy. She wouldn't eat, she was never happy. And she comes away with peace, and it's a startling, and it becomes overflow. We're going to see that in just a minute. It was such a relief from the burden that she had just had. She was forced to confront her own helplessness and behold God's absolute worthiness. She was forced to admit her inability and to say to God, only you, only you. Then in verse 20, we're going to see, it came to pass when the time was come after Hannah had conceived that she bare a son. She called his name Samuel because I asked him of the Lord. Verse 27, for this child I prayed, and the Lord hath given me my petition which I asked of him. And then look at verse 28. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there, speaking of Samuel as he has grown. He's still a little boy, but he's grown some. But we want to see here that she's kept her vow. Listen, that's called integrity. Would anybody have ever said, wow, you can't keep him? Come on, man. You need to give that boy away. No. She could have kept that kid. There wouldn't have been a person on the face of the earth that would have blamed her. But God would. Yes. She made a vow to God. We often make vows to God in prayer, not like this one. But when you pray to God and say, you're the only one,
amen,
I need for you to do this, you're my Father. These vows, you're making statements of your belief about God to him. You're saying, this is what I believe. I'm praying to you, and I can't see you, but I believe you're there, else I wouldn't pray. There's vows there. We need to live up to those vows. If he's your Father, treat him like your Father, your Heavenly Father. If he's the only one that cares for you, treat him like he's the only one that cares for you. If he's the only one that can fix it perfectly, treat him like he's the only one that fixes it perfectly. But she lived up to her vow. We ought to be faithful. Do you know that that's the one thing in our service that we'll be judged on?
Faith.
That's according to the writings in the New Testament. We see that it's required in a steward, somebody who's taking care of God's things, requiring a steward that a man be found faithful. Only one thing to be judged of: our faithfulness. Our faithfulness. And then let's look at the prayer. I hope you don't mind this going on a little bit long, but let's look at the prayer. We're looking to see this woman who finally has the baby. She gives him back, and instead of it being in the throes of sorrow and guilt and just can't get up, my baby is lost, the one I waited for all the years, look at what she prays. Chapter 2, verse 1 through 10. And Hannah prayed and said, now look what she says. She just gave her baby away for life. My heart rejoices in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth is in large over my enemies, because I rejoice in my salvation. What salvation is she talking about? Saved her from her burden. She never got over it. I got the baby. I prayed. He took that burden off of me, and 9 months later, I had a baby. And she still got that years later after she has weaned that baby and brought him into Eli. What does she say? I just rejoice in that salvation. I rejoice in what you've done for me. She never got over it. That's overflowing.
Amen.
Our salvation is another such event. Should be our soul's salvation. Should be an overflowing event. Should keep us back coming for more, thirsting for more, panting for water like an animal out in the desert. Verse 2, there is none holy as the Lord. There is none beside thee. Neither is there any rock like our God. Talk no more so exceeding proudly. See that pride there? Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty men are broken, and they that stumbled are girded with strength. They that were full have hired themselves out for bread. They that were hungry cease, so that a barren hath borne 7, and she that hath many children is waxed feeble. The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and he lifteth up. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill. He set them among princes and make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. Do you see what she's doing here? Loss of child and nothing but praise. And what, it's not just praise about that baby and that burden and her own salvation from God. It's my God. If he can do that, he can do anything that he wants. Don't you see what he's saying? He makes you poor. He makes you rich. He'll put you down. He'll bring you up. You that were rich are going to beg for bread. You that were poor will cease. There'll be no more need in your lives. And she goes on and on and on. You're capable of anything. So what will she do for the rest of her life? She'll always go back to this God that she, listen, she knows can do everything for her that needs done. And it'll be done perfectly. She had an overflowing moment. All of us need an overflowing moment in our lives, or several. Maybe we need weekly overflowing moments to where we just want more. And it's just God now. It's not me anymore. It's whatever God wants. Whatever he wants is what I want. We'll stop there, but concluding thoughts. Behold, this is God's grace. You remember 1 Peter 5:5? I'll read it. Look back there. Likewise, the younger, submit yourselves to the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, and clothed with humility. For God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. And we talked about that. The continuing work of grace in a humble heart, the one that needs him and shows him and tells him and acts like they need him all the time. Humble heart, there's continuing work of grace, and we can see this. Behold God's grace in this prayer. Do you not see it wasn't just the baby? It was all of a sudden, man alive, I am consumed with my God. Isn't that where we're headed? Where are we going to be in this next life, folks? We'll be in his presence, consumed with God. But we don't have to wait for that. We can lead that kind of a life now. God's grace given to the humble. Listen, Hannah, by God's grace, places her only child. Now look, listen. Where does she place this kid? With the God who delivered her. The best place she knew was where she got delivered, and that was with God. So what did she do with her offspring? I'm going to put you in the safest, most blessed spot there is, and that's with my God. Amen. I've proven it. There he is. I'm going to put my kid there. I couldn't be happier with my kid being, learning about God with this priest, Eli, being taught by Eli the priest. She put her only child in the only place that she knew to be a place of peace, rest, joy, fulfillment, because God cares. He cares for you. We behold our God. Did she behold her God? Look at the prayer. It wasn't just the baby. Look at her picture of God now in that prayer. We behold our God, and finally, by His grace, we are swept away if we ever see that big thing in our lives. And it might be tiny for somebody else, but it's your burden, and it's huge, and you can't deal with it, and you can't grow, and your thoughts are all crazy. And so what do? You cast it upon Him in humility and in humbleness, and we now get a good picture. As God answers that prayer, we get a perfect, more perfect picture of God, and it sweeps us away like we see in her prayer. Sweeps us away in awe, love, wonder, thanksgiving, and praise. The overflowing, pray for overflowing in your life. We can please God that way because it all goes to His glory. All goes to His glory. We'll stand now if you would. And we're going to have a short time of invitation. We'll say a prayer as the musicians are getting ready for the invitation song. Lord God, we do thank you so much for your words. Thank you for being a God that loves us so much, that cares for us so much, Lord. Increase our awareness and our picture of being, Lord. Help us to see you more like you truly are, Lord, and then be just swept away in awe, Lord, and wonder and grace, gratitude, love for you because of who you are. We'll thank you for that work, which is a work of grace. We praise you for it in Christ's name.
Amen. Page 270.
It's 270.
Just as I am.
At the time, this morning of invitation, if something you need to deal with it at your seats, but deal with it. Don't walk outside and do it later. Deal with it now. Pray. It doesn't have to be a long prayer. Something on your heart, deal with that this morning before you leave. Do it before you walk out the building. You come to the altar if you want. Pray here. Either way is fine, but pray.
Thank you again for this message, man. Father, we've heard this message for a reason.
even dollar that Hannah had, we can have it. We can have it. So it's gonna be up to us. And usually, God leave us, there's a lot of here hurting. If somebody wants to be here with us, can be. But you know all things, and all things are working for your good, not ours. So help us again, and now pray for our pastor. Pray for you, give our strength. Thank you for him, Father. When he came, as he ran from the men, he ran and he had laughed at the men, telling them about Christ. Now we can look at Alan's life and see what you can do. You can do it with anybody. So when we got people over here, God would help us. When we got people that said they don't want to hurt, look at Alan. You never know what God's going to do. Use and God will lead us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.